Oh, Jesus deserves the glory. Yes, Jesus deserves it all. He alone is holy is his name. Yes, holy is his name.
In Revelation 4:11 it says, "Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." The song we just sang is completely based on this scripture. In this chapter, angels are surrounding the throne, laying their crowns, bowing before the Lord, saying, "Worthy are you, Lord. Worthy of it all, Lord." So in these next few moments, I encourage you to join with us and the angels as we sing, "Worthy, worthy Jesus, you are worthy of it all.
As we end this time of prayer, I want to encourage you, and I want to remind you that God is worthy. What does that mean? It means that he's good. It means that he died, paid the price for you. It means that he's faithful. It means that he's consistent when no one else and nothing else is. God is worthy. So in this moment of prayer, I want to encourage you to thank God for who he is, for what he does, for how worthy he is. So, Lord, we praise you and we thank you because you are worthy. You are consistently and faithfully good to us. Lord, we cling to you because we need you, O Lord. You are worthy of it all. And so we give it all to you today, Jesus. We praise you and we thank you in your holy and in your precious name. Amen.
Hey church, I'm Korea, the GV Littles director. We are a generous church, so I know that many of you are looking for ways to give back to your community this holiday season. The Blessing Tree consists of a Target and Amazon registry where you can join us in partnering with families who could use a little help providing gifts for their children this Christmas. Down the street is a low-income school called Harmon Elementary. We will be collecting new coats, hats, gloves, and scarves to give to students, as well as money to to provide Thanksgiving dinner for families. You can also build a gift box for children around the world through Operation Christmas Child. For more information on any of these seasonal giving options, you can scan the QR code on the back of the chair in front of you or on your screen. Ladies, throw on some Christmas cozies and join us Friday, December 2nd for GV Women's Christmas event, Holly Jolly. It will be fun, festive, and full of surprises. You can register starting today. Now, let's dive into this week's message and discover what God has for us today.
Welcome, everybody. I'm so glad that you've joined us online. Wherever you are, welcome, GV Christian Online. And I wanted to give you a quick gym update, gymnasium. For those of you who may not know and you're tuning in for the first time, we are building a gymnasium. It's been a long time coming, a lot of prayer, a lot of thought, a lot of decisions that we've asked God wisdom for. God has opened an incredible door, a series of miracles, and so we are underway. In the last 2 weekends, I shared with everyone an opportunity to be able to just participate rather than just watching it go up, and maybe you've seen pictures online. You actually can have a part in it and take ownership. It's just no fun just to sit back and watch. I love it when I can get involved, do something. So Megan and I prayed, and there's a QR code right there on the screen, and you can participate by giving to the gym. God is doing amazing things in our church, and the biggest thing at GV Christian is a changed life, healing, and people being set free by the power of God. And God wants His church to be blessed, and the way God wants His church to be blessed, and His work to move forward, and the way that God designed for His church to move forward is by our giving together. And as you just heard Korea say, it's just, Pastor Korea, it's just an amazing thing to be a part of a generous church. And you allow our church to dream as far as we can dream based on your giving. So here, just in the last few weeks and even beyond that, here's a total amount so far towards equipping the gym. You can see it also at gvchristian.com on our website, just over $85,000. So hooray for that. We're thankful for that. And I can't thank you enough for your generosity. Now, last weekend, the first 10 commandments and laws were spoken to Moses. We looked at that in Exodus chapter 20. We're in this series called Exodus. It's the second book in your Bible if you're following along or scrolling in your mobile device. They were spoken to Moses and the people. And this weekend, we're going to see that Moses now goes up to the mountain as we took a look at as we concluded Exodus 20. And he begins to receive the law library from the Lord that would guide them. It would protect them in this fledgling nation. It would bring untold blessings to this new nation. In addition to the first 10 now are 603 additional boundaries, instructions, laws for their sake. It's to have a peaceful and a just nation that all of the other nations would look at them and say, what a Lord you have. What a God you have. There's nothing compared to the God, small g, that we have. We want what you have. And that's always God's desire, to spread this good news around every person that's ever walked and ever lived in the face of this planet or ever will. Now, after the initial 10 commandments, the next three chapters, Exodus 21, 22, and 23, begin with the rest of the ordinances and the laws and the boundaries. So we really covered the reason behind those laws and ordinances last couple of weeks. Now, these three chapters, 21, 22, and 23, they're not just chapters that you want to say. And anybody besides me, have you ever done this? Have you ever, especially when I was young in the Lord and I had a decision to make, and I was kind of desperate for a decision. Anybody besides me ever do this? And so you go, I wonder if the Lord has a word for me. And you open the Bible and you go, anybody ever done that? So, yeah, and I remember doing that. And so, look, these chapters are not the chapters that you ever want to do that. As an example, if you were to open up and say, okay, God, do you have a word for me? And then it lands on Exodus 21, the first of these three chapters we're going to look at. Verse 28, it says this, if an ox gores a man or a woman to death, the ox, I got to speak English, Gary. The ox must be stoned and its flesh may not be eaten in such a case. However, the owner will not be held liable. Okay, two out of three. And this time, be sure to open it in the New Testament. In other instructions, God says this, look, you're responsible for what your animal does to someone else. Three chapters of this kind of stuff in an agricultural society. And it's like, are you kidding me? What does this have to do with me? When the Bible is the word of God from Genesis to Revelation, what does it have to do with where I live? Has anyone had your ox gore? Anyone lately? Well, we're not going to go verse by verse, and that's good news, isn't it? Otherwise, I would lose you in the first few. You'd be gone and tune out, and I'd empty the room. But many of these laws don't apply to us today. But, listen very carefully, but the principles behind them do apply. And these principles are the backbone of any decent civilization, including our own. So that's what we're going to do this weekend. We're going to see the principles behind these three chapters and look at them from about 30,000 feet and ask, what difference do these laws and these boundaries and these ordinances make in my life? You know what? I'm just trying to pay the bills. I'm just trying to get my kids to school and then get to work. And I'm just trying to buy groceries and put gas in the tank. But behind every law is a principle that will apply to every single area of your life. What areas? Every single area. And there are principles of social order, justice, relationships, how to live when you're broken and when you're struggling in life, and learning to live with other broken people who are struggling in life. So God says, here's how you're going to learn to live with each other and be different from all of the other nations who are driven by their sinful desires to do whatever whim and whatever wish, wherever it took them. So there are laws about personal injury laws. There are property laws. There's murder and manslaughter, and to know the difference between the two. There's laws of restitution. There's persecution. What happens when there's crime? What about persecution? So there are laws about that. There are laws about rape. There are laws about lending and loans. There are laws about employee and being an indentured servant laws. There are laws about being a conscientious citizen of a community. There are laws that talk about days off, Sabbath laws. There are laws and instructions about a time and a place of worship. There are days to celebrate and days and laws about feasting. God loves to celebrate and call for times of feasting. So they begin now, these other 603 after the initial 10 in chapter 21. And they're expounded not only in chapters 21, 22, and 23, as we take just a bird's eye view once again of these, but they're expounded in the other books of the law. Where are those books of the law? They're called the Pentateuch, which means five books of the law, from penta and tuch, meaning law, Genesis through Deuteronomy. So the laws and the ordinances and the boundaries that God set are in those five books. It's one book, five parts. We're just talking about one part as we're going through the series in Exodus. And there are some weird verses in these chapters. Let me just read another one to you in Exodus 22. Verse 1 says this, if a man steals an ox or a sheep and slaughters or sells it, he must repay five oxen for an ox and four sheep for a sheep. How many sheep? Four sheep. Like restitution? Four times in the case of a sheep. First thing that came to my mind was a guy by the name of Zacharias in Luke chapter 19. You can read about him. And his encounter with Jesus, he was a greedy thief who, under the protection of the law of Romans, he stole from people. He was corrupt. Jesus encounters him on the road in Jericho, and he invites himself over to his house for the day. And at the end, Zacchaeus says this, you know what? I've ripped off so many people. And those that I have ripped off and stolen from, I will repay four times. How many times? Four times what I stole from them. Whoa. Now, do we follow these laws today, all of them? No. Why? The answer is because much of the laws given were for that culture and for that time. But the principles behind them never change. So let me give you an example. As an example, there is a pattern that's repeated in the Bible on more than one occasion, and it was a part of their culture. They didn't think anything about it. But even in our chapters 21 through 23, it's not a part of our culture, but it was a part of their culture once again, and this was the culture. A dowry was paid and was given for a daughter in order for you to marry them. A dowry was paid. Now, in our culture, as an example, Meg and I have two daughters, and Meg and I paid for the wedding of our daughters, and I lost my last name. I paid for the wedding in which my daughters lost my last name. What's up with that? I should have declared what the Bible says and claimed, look, if you marry my daughter, it's going to cost you big time. So, in Exodus 21, what is God saying to us today? What can we glean from the principles? Here's the first principle, Exodus 21. It's the principle of choosing who will be your master. Listen very carefully. I'm going to repeat it in a little bit. Every single one of us are mastered by something. The difference is what you choose to be mastered by. So let's read just a little bit of Exodus 21, verse 1 says this, these are the regulations you must present to Israel. If you buy a Hebrew slave, he may serve for no more than 6 years. Set him free in the seventh year, and he will owe you nothing for his freedom. Now, we're going to spend just a few moments on not only these verses, but also on the first 11 verses of this chapter. Because as I read this chapter, there is no way that I can really look at these verses without thinking of the tragic and horrific history of slavery in our young nation. I mean, who would think that in our young history as a nation, the United States, that capturing someone, owning them, treating them the same as livestock, or even worse, working them to death and beating them and selling them and separating families, that somehow would be okay. And it's been happening since the beginning of nations, long before Exodus 21. So verse 1 and verse 2, why would God start with this one? If God would have said, look, you're the people of God, there is no slavery, and make that the 11th commandment, it may have saved our nation a lot of pain and a lot of people a lot of pain. Why not start with murder or rape or violent crimes? And yet this God of love seems to allow slavery by not forbidding it and yet talking about it in 11 verses. Now, slavery was happening once again for centuries before this chapter, but we have to, it's not to excuse it, but we have to understand, have some kind of understanding when it comes to context, context, and context. Let me say it again, not for the purpose of justifying slavery or anything, but we have to, just for a moment, set aside the injustice of what happened in our country and other nations in the history of the world, still going on today, in order to understand what God is doing here. So there were four reasons for Hebrew servants or slaves. Four reasons. Here's number one, extreme poverty. Extreme poverty. It was the most common reason. It was necessary for people in extreme poverty to pay a debt in order to feed their family. There were no bankruptcy laws. There were no credit cards. There was no buy now or pay later. And in many cases, think in terms of an apprenticeship. And God expounds on this in this commandment in Leviticus chapter 25, where God says, and this isn't the only place he says this, in the fourth book of the law, Leviticus, he says, if a countryman or countrywoman among you becomes destitute and in this case sells himself to you, then you must not force him into slave labor. Let him stay with you as a hired worker or temporary resident. He is to work for you until the year of Jubilee. Until what? I want it to sink in. What? The year of Jubilee. We're going to come back to that. Then he and his children are to be released, and he may return to the clan and to the property of his fathers. Now look, if I become destitute, and Meg and our three kids and five grandkids are starving, destitute, and we owe. And if I need to indenture myself to someone who can help me provide for my family without compromising any values or any biblical values in my life, not compromising my walk with God, then I'll do what I need to do. But it was not an option then. There were no bankruptcy laws. There's no Social Security. There's no welfare. There's no government payouts. And in the meantime, when they did this, they learned how to plant. They became an indentured person where they learned how to plant, how to water, how to harvest, and other trades, how to build, how to repair, how to engineer. And bankruptcy is also when you just are absolutely bankrupt. When everything that you have financially is gone, it's also included in this. You owe, so off to work you go for the person you owe the debt to. But always, as we expound on it, and you see through the law, it's to be treated with respect, and you work until the debt is paid or until the seventh year. Number two, crime. Crime. Let's take a look at Exodus 22, verse 3. It says this: anyone who steals must certainly make restitution. Everybody say restitution. But if they have nothing, they must be sold to pay for their theft. Sold? Once again, they become in order to pay back what they have stolen. If they have nothing, maybe they turned it into a pawn shop. Well, you know, they didn't have pawn shops. Whatever they did, they had to make restitution. Restitution is so huge, as we're about to see in just a little bit. Now, the third reason was what I've already mentioned, and already touched on this one, a daughter to be married. Now, a good example of that was a guy by the name of Jacob and two wives, Rachel and Leah. Good example. Number four, for those of you not familiar with it, you can find it in Genesis, first book of the Bible. And then number four, now I'm going to unpack this more in just a little bit, but number four, restitution. God's goal in these first 11 verses is to see a goal of being set free. 6 years, and then there's freedom. A year of Jubilee, when the debt would be absolutely considered to be paid in full. Freedom given. And listen very carefully. The question is not, why did God allow slavery and servanthood and apprenticeships and to be an indentured servant? The question is, when did slavery end? It ended in Exodus. When God said, there is to be a time every 7 years when everyone is set free. Everyone is the same, debt free. There's a year of Jubilee when every debt owed by the family, by the kids, by the entire family is wiped clean, gone. For those of you, what is it? I think the average national credit card debt now is something like $18,000 with interest rates. Just, wouldn't that be amazing? Would that be a license for, I'm just going to charge up. I'm at 6 months and, you know, I'm at 6 years rather, and 9 months, man, I'm going to go out and charge because on the seventh year. No, it was wiped clean. A year of Jubilee. Deuteronomy
15:1. The fifth book of the law says this: at the end of every seventh year, you must cancel the debts of who? Everyone. Of who? Everyone who owes you money. Financial times come, don't they? Whether you're young and just starting out, maybe a student, whether you're later in life and health all of a sudden takes a sudden downturn, whether your kids are in need of the most expensive sports shoes in the history of the world. I'll get a laugh with that one on Sunday, but anyway, you can edit that out, you guys. But what does that mean today? What does it mean for us? The day that Jesus came, listen, the day that Jesus came and everyone is given the option of being set free in a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. What's the connection between the law in Exodus 21, the year of Jubilee, debt being forgiven? All of us, before we come to know Jesus, are slaves to sin. When Jesus began his public ministry, he said this. In Luke chapter 4, he was handed a scroll. It was a portion of the book of Isaiah. And it was the first thing after being water baptized by John, coming up out of the water, and the Spirit descends on him in the form of a dove. And a voice from heaven says, "This is my Son with whom I am well pleased. Listen, listen to him." And the first words, as Jesus was in the synagogue after that, as he reads from Isaiah, are these words: "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor." That's poor spiritually. "He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressive free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." What year is that? It's the year of Jubilee. It's the seventh year, spiritually speaking, where Jesus comes to set us free from all of our debt because of sin and heartache and brokenness. It's debt-free living from sin and death and pain. It's an abundant life today and eternal life forever. Oh, this is good stuff. It's going to get even better. Anybody want to live debt-free? Guilt-free living. And the means of paying back debt, paying back the debt for the Israelites brought some means of fairness in the broken world. But the goal was freedom, a year of Jubilee in which the debt was forgiven. In Jesus, he paid our debt. He set us free. You cannot pay the debt that you owe. There's nothing that you can do to pay it on your own for living life your way. Jesus became a slave for us to pay the debt for you and me. Look at this verse. Jesus said this: "For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others and to give his life as a ransom for many." Now, let me say it again. Every single one of us are mastered by something, and we can choose who our master will be. And maybe before you came to know Jesus, if you've taken that step, your master maybe was an addiction, maybe money. Maybe your own emotions, your fear and your worry. Maybe the whims of a culture. Maybe it was the government. We choose who or what we will be a slave to. And I love what Paul, the apostle, that word means one who is sent. Paul said this as he wrote, as God spoke through him, this letter to the church at Rome. And he said this: "This letter is from Paul, a slave of Christ Jesus, chosen by God to be an apostle and sent out to preach his good news." They all said this. They all said, "I'm a slave. I'm a servant." James said it. Peter said it. They all said the same thing. I am first and foremost, it's my identity to be a slave of Christ Jesus. Our freedom comes in choosing who our master will be. And it's your choice. It's your choice to either allow Jesus to be your master or to allow fear and worry or the economy or inflation. The name of Jesus is above the name of any economy and any government and any king, president, prime minister. Now, I have the right to do anything I please, and you do too. But this is what God said through Paul. He said, look, I have the right to do anything. I can choose to have anything by my master. And you say this, but not everything is beneficial. I have the right to do anything, but I will not be mastered by anything. It begs the question, what are you being mastered by? Our freedom comes in choosing who will be the master over us and who we will be a slave to. Joshua dealt with this. God by the name of Joshua, spokesperson for God. He said this in Joshua 24. He said, look, if you refuse to serve the Lord, it's our choice. If you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today. Choose today whom you'll serve, be a slave to. Would you prefer the gods, small g, your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates? Or will it be the gods of the Amorites in whose land you now live? But as for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. I love that. So this is what God says in these chapters regarding his laws. Exodus 23, he says, you must serve only the Lord your God. So it's about being a servant. It's about being a slave. It's about the freedom we have in Jesus. You must serve only the Lord your God. If you do, I will bless you with food and water. I will protect you from illness. There will be no miscarriages or infertility in your land, and I will give you long, full lives. What an amazing promise God made. There's so much more that could be said in it, so much there. The law is given to bless and protect and to give, and that sums up God's love for you. Now, let's wrap up chapters 22 and 23. So what are the principles there? It's the principles of choosing peace, and then a word we've already mentioned, restitution. Restitution. Now, all three chapters talk about making things right, making some kind of restitution with those you have wronged. And if you are wronged, not taking out our own revenge. So that's included in these chapters too. And what God is talking about when it comes to restitution is not accidental circumstances, but intentional neglect. So these laws, one after another, that talk about if you have intentional neglect, if you've been warned, maybe you've been warned about an animal that keeps destroying things and keeps injuring people and just, you know, aggressive animal, and you've been warned about the potential danger of this, or maybe the potential danger of a fire because you were doing some things that presented a hazard, bringing harm to your neighbors, but they ignored the warnings and they just go ahead anyway, and they put the property or life of somebody, their neighbor, even their family, in harm's way. So God makes distinctions between intentional neglect and unintentional accidents. So here's an example, Exodus 22. Once again, I told you we wouldn't read verse by verse. We'd lose. I mean, I would lose it. So yeah, just trying to go through all of these in a short period of time. But verse 12 says this, if the animal was actually stolen from the neighbor, he must make restitution to the owner. If the animal was torn to pieces by that, maybe attacked by a wild animal, whether it was a mountain lion or a wolf, he shall bring it as evidence. He need not make restitution for the torn carcass. Now, we've already read that a thief in Exodus 22 must make full restitution. That's a no-brainer, right? Somebody breaks into your home, steals something, it's got to make restitution. It's got to make it right. Mercy without justice is just chaos. Justice without mercy is cruelty, two sides of the same coin. So in Exodus 22, verse 5, it says this, if a man grazes his livestock in a field or vineyard and allows them to stray so that they graze in someone else's field, he must make restitution from the best of his own field or vineyard. I love that. You ever borrowed something, or has somebody ever borrowed it from you, and even though they returned it, they didn't return it the same way? The amount of restitution depends on the loss or the intentional neglect or disregard. So what's the principle from all of this? Here's the principle, and as Jesus followers, what God does expect when we've done wrong to others. Or if we've been wronged, it's included in that. We're going to zero in on if you've wronged others. All of us have at one time or another, we have been wronged or we have wronged others. And here's the principle. Restitution is the only way to make it right. Restitution means to make it whole or complete or restored. And just being sorry doesn't cut it. Have you ever been wrong? Maybe in a marriage relationship, parent-child relationship, something, you know, whatever, maybe in a work, and somebody, you know, says, well, I said I was sorry. Thanks a lot. I lost income. My family has been hurt. I lost this. And you're just sorry, kind of flippant? Well, I said I was sorry. Just move on. Forget about it. There's some huge principles and applications for every single one of us today. And this applies in so many ways. When a person steps across the line into a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ, it begins a transformation from the inside out. And there are so many ministries that we have here to help you. Among them is a ministry called Celebrate Recovery. And it's those that have been slaves or they've been mastered by anything in their life, maybe an addiction, maybe abuse that they handed out towards others. And the list goes on and on and on. But as they begin to grow and as they begin to mature as a Jesus follower, eventually one of the things in Celebrate Recovery they're encouraged to do is to make a list of the more, eventually, not overnight, takes time, and that is to make a list of the morally bad that a person has done to others or others have done to you. And then eventually to go over that list with a trusted coach, a mentor, sponsor. And they help you to determine the things that were actually your responsibility. These are all principles that are in the Word of God, intentional neglect or unintentional. And it's asking God through the process of His Holy Spirit and the power of His Word to root out the character flaws and the reason behind those wrongs. And then work on becoming willing to make amends, restitution is what that word means, and actually make amends eventually to those wronged, as long as it doesn't harm or hurt others, because it's not always possible to go to a person maybe that you abused or hurt or wronged. Maybe they've died, but there are other ways. Jesus dealt with this. He said in Matthew chapter 5, he said this, therefore, if you're offering your gift at the altar and there, remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar and first go and be reconciled to them, then come and offer your gift. The purpose of restitution is reconciliation and restoration of a relationship. And this is what happens. It sets people free. And that's what God's commandments were intended to do. And when we sin, when we've wronged against God and others, Jesus doesn't tell us just to be sorry. Well, just say you're sorry. He wants us to repent. And that means we're going in one direction and we move in another direction, just really feeling bad about it, and we say, oh, we're good, let's move on. There's godly sorrow, but God says, now I want you to turn around and I want you to go in a different direction. That always involves some kind of action. My words of being sorry mean nothing if the harmful actions are repeated over and over and over again, no matter how big the tears are, if the actions never change. Maybe a person is abusive once again, and it's not possible once again to find that person that you abused. But with Jesus' help, you can make amends through other means, maybe to be generous towards a particular ministry, maybe supporting a shelter, maybe volunteering in a homeless outreach, maybe it's participating in financial peace. You are a robber and a stealer and a thief, and it's not possible to even find all the people that you ripped off. And so you become just growing in Financial Peace University, where you can help others. I love Proverbs 14, verse 9 says this, fools mock at making amends for sin. Have you ever seen somebody? Are you kidding me? I'm not going to go to them and ask forgiveness and make a fool of my fools. Mock at making amends for sin, but goodwill is found among the upright. Here's the capstone, and here's the reason behind this principle of restitution. You ready for it? Here it is. Jesus is our restitution. Let's say it together. Jesus is our restitution. There are 613 commandments that I can't live up to, never have, never will be able to on this side of eternity, and neither have you. I can never completely make right my own wrongs, my failures, my mistakes, but there is one who can. His name is Jesus. I love this verse. In 1 John, a book called 1 John, towards the end of your Bible, just before you get to Revelation, says this, we have an advocate. That means like an attorney who pleads, defends your case. We have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice. That word atoning is a synonym for restitution. The word atoning is a synonym for restitution. Jesus made amends for you personally. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. An advocate, an attorney who defends us, who protects us. He made amends. He atoned for our sins, and he declared us guilt-free in his name. I can choose to live differently because I have received his freedom and his power living on the inside of me, changing me from the inside out and transforming even the way that I think. The Bible says this, whom the Son has set free is free indeed from the debt and the slavery to sin and to be mastered by so many things. Real freedom begins by being a slave and deciding to be a servant to Jesus Christ. Not my will, but your will, Jesus. And I will serve you until my last dying breath. How many can say amen? Would you pray with me? I want to pray with you. As we're in prayer, you've been wronged. Maybe recently or maybe a long time ago, and I'm sorry that happened to you. No one deserves to be wronged, but we live in a broken world. And it's like a tape on occasion, and it just replays in your mind over and over again. And at times, it can hurt just as bad as the moment that it happened. But Jesus is here to set you free. He is your servant. Jesus wants to declare a year of jubilee for you. It may not even be possible for you to go and somehow confront or talk to the person who wronged you. But Jesus knows all about it. He knows every detail of every wrong and hurt. And he paid the price for that. And at some point, with God's help and with the support of a church family like here at GV Christian, at some point you must move towards forgiveness and to be free. Let me say it again. It's why we have life groups, why we have Celebrate Recovery. Because Jesus doesn't want you to carry around the poison any longer. And if truth be known, maybe you've wronged someone and you've kind of brushed it off. They've tried to tell you maybe and you don't want to hear it. Well, I said I'm sorry. Not enough? Maybe a spouse, maybe a friend, a loved one. The Bible says this, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with everyone. And there are so many ways of approaching people. For some people, it's expressing regret. For some, they may need to hear that you accept responsibility and just simply say, I'm wrong. For some of you, that's like choking on a huge piece of meat to say that, to say I'm wrong. For some of you, to say this, what can I do to make this right, if there's anything? And genuinely repenting, not just by words, but by your action. And then asking, will you please forgive me? It takes a real man and a real woman to say, will you forgive me? And you've done what you can do. So far as it depends on you, be at peace with everyone. It's God's desire to set you free. So, Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for the power of your word and the principles behind these commandments and these laws. We're to give a peaceful nation, a blessed nation, a nation that could get along with each other as best as possible. It wasn't perfect because there were imperfect people involved. And they broke these and they failed as a nation. But Jesus, that's why you came. But you gave 613 laws to show us how much we need you. And so we give you thanks and praise. Pray this prayer. Would you, Jesus, I accept you as my Savior, my Lord. I want to be your servant. I want to be your slave. I don't want to be mastered any longer by what's been controlling me and mastering me. I want you to be my master. I want to be your slave. In Jesus' name, amen. Stretch your hands. Would you, Father, bless your people with your power and with your grace, with your goodness? Would you protect them and guide them as only you can? Thank you for the power and the principles of your word. Would you lift up the light of your countenance and give them your peace in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you. I love you. Wait until next weekend. We'll see you then.
Your pastoral staff would love to pray with you, would love to come alongside you, would love to do life with you together. Link in the description in the chat or on gvchristian.com under links to our connection card. There you can fill out a prayer request where your pastoral staff, we read over those every single day. Maybe you want to say, you know, I prayed that prayer for the first time today. I've engaged with God today. I desire a relationship with him today. You can fill out that connection card and a member of our pastoral staff will reach out to you this week. Maybe you want to get water baptized or you want to dedicate a baby that you've recently had. Other ways that you can connect with God by filling out that connection card. Maybe you have a question about this weekend's message. Fill out that prayer request. Let us know. We receive these requests every single day. We would love to connect with you. Church, thanks for joining us this week. We love you. Have a great week.